series, we're going to the book of Nehemiah, and we're in chapter 8 today, so you can turn to Nehemiah chapter 8, find it there on your phone if you want, and we'll meet you right there, Nehemiah chapter 8. Let's pray together. Father, thanks for your word. Thank you, God, how you nourish our souls with your word, how you speak to us. And Father, we pray that our joy would grow as we seek you today, and we pray in your name, Lord. Amen. Work can be challenging. Would you agree? Amen. Amen. Or school. When I say work, it could be school. It could be parenting. The role that you have where you put most of your time and energy during the week, it can be challenging. It can be thrilling. It can be compelling and sometimes even consuming. But our work is one of the ways that we live out our faith and walk with God. Now, in the book of Nehemiah, they're working. They're rolling up their sleeves. They're completing this incredible project for God. And it's been a project that's been on hold in some ways because of apathy and fear. But 150 years, they did not rebuild Jerusalem. And then in two short months, moving forward together, united with God's strength, Jerusalem, the city, is being rebuilt. And so they're doing all this work for the Lord, and it's incredible what they're accomplishing. And then we reach chapter 8. And in chapter 8, they step back from their work. Because God, who has been walking them through their work, now he's going to work on their hearts. And so today, you might have a lot of things that you're involved in, and you might think of your work and all these responsibilities, but I ask you today in our time together to step back from that, just take your mind off that for a little while we're gathered here today, and let God speak to your heart. Let him, just your time with the Lord and what he wants to do in your heart, because that's exactly what's happening in Nehemiah chapter 8. So let's go there, and let's take a look at some of the experiences that God wants us to have and to enjoy, starting in verse 1. When the seventh month came, and the Israelites had settled in their towns, all the people assembled as one man in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra the scribe to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women, and all who were able to understand. And the experience they have together is spiritual unity. God wants all of us to have that taste of spiritual unity. Well, where do we see this? There's two people, Ezra and Nehemiah. Very different, each running their own race and their own lane, but united. So Ezra came back from exile 14 years before Nehemiah. Ezra is one of the religious leaders. He's solid. I know in the Bible, a lot of times religious leaders are corrupt, but he's solid. He's teaching the word. He's living it out. And so that's his role. Nehemiah, who came 14 years later, he's more of a project leader and a political leader. But that's where God has led him. So both are very important. And they're both abiding and responding. They're teaming up together. You almost get this sense of looking over at each other saying, God can do something amazing in our city. I know it. I know it. Use your gift, and I'll use mine. What has he called you to do? And this is what he's called me to do. And let's support each other. Let's pray for each other. Let's see what God's going to do. Do you have an Ezra or a Nehemiah in your life that's just right there beside you? And together, you just know God can do something great here. And let's spur each other on. And so there's this incredible unity. And we see with Ezra and Nehemiah, and then that just continues. As the leaders start, the whole group is on board with that unity. And a powerful phrase, we read, the people are together as one. As one. Men and women, as one. Adults and children, as one. All generations, as one. I think of our church here, coming together as one, all the people, there's unity and diversity. And that's God's plan, to have a unity that's strengthened through diversity. Now, when we say diversity, I know some people today just want to throw sin in that too and say, oh, diversity including sin. Sin is not part of God's beautiful design of diversity. But what is part of his design is people of different ages, races, ethnicities, personalities, roles, talents. That's a beautiful diversity, different nations coming together, and that strengthens
unity. So it's a unity that is a foundation with so much diversity. And we see that being played out in this chapter, and that's something that God wants us to cherish, enjoy, and guard. In Ephesians chapter 4 in the New Testament, these are some insights into the unity that we desire. Verse 2, be completely humble and gentle. You don't have unity unless people are humble and gentle. So be humble, be gentle, be patient, bear with one another in love. Now make every effort, in the Greek, every means every, all, make full effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. For there is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. So God's word is so clear. Guard the unity. Guard the unity in your marriage. The two become one. Guard the unity in your life group, in your church. Guard it. The Holy Spirit brings unity. Our role is to guard that unity. You say, well, how do you do that? Just what we read in Ephesians. You focus on what you have in common. You focus on the most important stuff. One Lord, one faith, one hope, one love. There's all kinds of, you know, little opinions that float around, and you can get sidetracked, but you focus on the most important stuff. You focus on what we have in common. You focus on the Lord, and in that love, as you're patient and humble, God guards the unity. God is so pleased when there's unity. God is so pleased, and He wants that. We know that's His will, and the people are tasting it. It's an unusual unity in Nehemiah, and we also want to have that unusual unity. Here's the second piece. Drop down to verse 3. In verse 3, Ezra read the scripture aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra the scribe, he stood on a high wooden platform built for this occasion. So they were experiencing time in God's word, and Ezra opened up the scripture, started at daybreak, so just before sunrise, and went all the way to noon. Would you say that's a pretty long sermon? My math says that's over 5 hours. Anyone ready for some of that? Over 5 hours of revival. And it's like, we're not ready for revival. So, you know, these sermons we do in 30 minutes, these little sermonettes, you see, it's biblical. 5 hours, it's biblical. We're not going to do it. We're not going to do 5 hours. I don't have 5 hours ready. You need lunch. But here they go. And the point is, they are attentive. They are thirsty for God's word. And God's word, it's like no other book that we have. Now, it was a scroll at that point, you know, that Ezra would open up. But God's word is truth. God's word is eternal. We can't say that about other books. God's word is God-breathed. It is the firm foundation for our lives in our church. At every age group, in every ministry, come back to God's word. It's reliable. It's our source of truth. And as you think about God's word today in churches, there's some churches that kind of belittle God's word. And there's less and less of God's word. We live in a culture that's becoming less and less familiar with the scripture. And even in churches, some people go to churches and they're not studying God's word. So that's not the case here. We are all about God's word. But then here's another extreme to avoid. I was talking to someone, not from our church, but from a different church, and he kind of said tongue in cheek, he said, the Trinity, the Holy Trinity at our church is Father, Son, and Holy Scripture. I was like, what? He said, yeah, we never talk about the Holy Spirit. All we just talk about is the Word is elevated where the Word, you know, the Bible is almost God, the Trinity. And I said, well, that's heresy. That's heresy. Because here at our church, we love the Holy Spirit. We talk about the Holy Spirit. We want to be filled with the Spirit, empowered with the Spirit. The Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, all equal, all beautiful. And we celebrate. But God's Word, so the Bible, you know, don't let it become an idol, but at the same time, make sure you're, how much time do you get in God's Word? You ever think about that during the week? I mean, they're hungry for 5 straight hours of God's Word. What does it look like for you? It's never been more accessible. I mean, you can listen to CD, you can listen to preaching. I mean, there's apps, you can read it at home. I mean, it's so many different translations, versions, study Bibles, life application Bibles, one-year Bibles. I mean, it is everywhere. It's never been more accessible, but it's not until we value it and we say, you know, I want that. I need that. I want to build my life on, I just don't want to hear from the culture all the time. I want to hear from God. I want to commune with God. I want to listen to God. I want to get in His Word. And that's why we have life groups here at the church. That's why they're so central. Because, you know, when we break into a smaller group, then you're hearing from other people and you're talking about the Word and what did it mean in your life this week and you're applying it. And so, you know, that's why you have life groups. If you're not sure about getting into God's Word and that's new to you, I encourage you to get a Life Application Bible, a study Bible online. There's things called commentaries. And you think commentary, comments, a lot of insights, truth about the Word help build you up, get you used to studying God's Word. Go to your life group leader. Go to a pastor. But they are being strengthened and edified by God's Word. And one of the verses that stood out to me in my life is Ezra chapter 7, verse 10, because I think this is a complete picture of, you know, with God's Word coming into our lives. Ezra chapter 7, verse 10 says, "For Ezra had devoted himself to the study, but also observance of the law of the Lord, and to teaching its decrees and laws." So God's Word, we want to soak it up, intake, and it's not just getting in His Word, but His Word gets in you. And so Colossians 3:16, let the Word of God dwell in you richly. So studying it, intake, that's the first part. But a lot of people stop there, and they're just into the knowledge. And the knowledge is good, but you know they're loading up more and more of God's Word. But there's a second part, and that's applying it, living what you've just learned. So not the goal, the end goal is not just learning, but then it's living out what you learn. And then part of that living out, the third thing, is to pass it on to other people. So think about God's Word in your life. Is it a priority? Are you soaking it up? Are you living it? And then are you passing it, sharing it with other people? Maybe just a verse and a text, but are you sharing it? So that's the flow. That's why God gives us His Word, this love letter, so it flows through our lives like that. And when we do that, then it's powerful. Because you get a community doing that, that's really, everyone gets strengthened, it built up and close with God. Do you know how they describe the Israelites? As they were doing this and rediscovering this, they said, "These are a people of the book." What a compliment. A people of the book. They soak up God's Word, they live it, and they share it with each other and with other people. They are a people of the book. Wouldn't that be great if Grace Community Church got described as, you know, those people? They're a people of the book. They experience God's Word. They experience God's Word. So here's another third piece to this. Drop down to verse 5. And in Nehemiah, still in chapter 8, verse 5, we read, "As Ezra opened up the book, all the people, they could see him because he was standing above them as he opened it. The people then all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people, they lifted their hands and they responded, 'Amen, amen.' Then they bowed down, they worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground." And I see in those verses a hunger for God. Do you have an appetite for God? Are you stuffing that appetite with other things? Or are you going and seeking God directly, seeking His face? Ezra says, "He is the Lord. He is the great God." And how do the people respond? Verse 11, they're still. They're still. That isn't so common in our culture, is it? I mean, we are people on the move. We're going faster. We're doing more things. To just be still before the Lord. Know He's in control. Know He's good. Rest. Know He loves you. Be secure in Him. Respect, reverence. Be still. That's one thing they did. Another thing they did was they lifted up their hands. They lifted up their arms, and they were worshiping. And when I became a Christian, this was in college, I just kind of decided internally, I was not a Christian who lifts up my hands or arms. That's not me. And I held that position for a number of years, and then eventually, I was part of a church in Concord Missionary Baptist Church in South Oak Cliff in Dallas, Texas, and as I began to worship there, and people were raising their hands, guess what started to happen to my hands? They started going up. And I kind of, you know, was fighting it and thinking, I don't know. And as I was looking at the Bible, I was like, wait a second. I'm like, this is throughout the Bible. Old Testament, Psalms, New Testament, pray, hands lifted up. I'm not saying you're more spiritual if you lift up your hands. I'm not saying you have to lift up your hands. Don't twist this around. But what I am saying is that if you, you know, desire to worship the Lord, your hands up, you're just saying, God, you are so great. And God, I surrender to you. And I just give you all my praise. And you can give them all your praise with your hands down or hands up. But it's just that bodily expression of what's going on in the heart. Well, what else did they do? They shouted, amen. Did they say it once?
No,
they said it twice. Amen. But there was still a little more praise in there, and they said amen again. One just wasn't quite enough because they're passionate. And the point here is not, you know, be still, get your hands raised, say amen, just at the right times, right way. No, they're experiencing God in an authentic way. And out of that relationship and closeness to God, these things are just, they're happening as expressions of love for the Lord. And one other thing they did, they worshiped, and that word right there for worship means they went down, prostrate on the ground. So the Hebrew word is just to the ground. And I know that's not something we do here. We tend to stay seated, and sometimes we stand up. But again, you go to the Bible, and it's so often face down. And they're just, God, you are so great. And I know you love me, but who am I? But you love me, and I fail you, but you love me. And just respecting the Lord face down. And so all this is happening. What I'm trying to say is there's no substitute for God and for just meeting directly with God. And when we don't connect directly with God, there's an emptiness in there. And it can be during the day, or it can be, you know, gradually realize how far we've drifted. But that emptiness we try to fill with other things. And the scripture keeps telling us, seek God, seek his face, go the living God. I don't know how it is for you, but during the week for me, things get sometimes busy, sometimes complicated, sometimes disappointing, sometimes stressful. And it's like, well, where do you go with that? And in the middle of all that, I'll just say, I want you, God. Yeah. Nothing else can do. I need you, and I love you. And just go right to him. So that's what they're doing. They're reconnecting with the living God. And God wants us to have that rich experience. The opposite of being self-centered is worship and connecting with God. It sets us free. And so out of that, these fresh applications in their life start to break out. Look at verse 8. They says, they read from the book of the law, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people could understand what was being read. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, this day is sacred to the Lord your God, so do not mourn or weep. For all the people, they had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is sacred to the Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Say that again. The joy of the Lord is your strength. The Levites calmed all the people, saying, be still, for this is a sacred day. Do not grieve. Then all the people went away to eat, to drink, to send portions of food, and to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. Fresh applications from God's word. I was thinking about all the advertisement we're bombarded with, and all the companies and people telling us, do this, buy this, go to this, you got to have this. I got a postcard this week to Jesse Bradley, that's me, and it's from Great Clips. I think you're picking up on the irony here, right? Sent right to me, great haircut, great price, Great Clips. And they have this picture of this guy with thick hair, just like I used to have 15 years ago. Look kind of like that. And it just hurts to get this card. It just hurts. But you're here for me. And it just says, Great Clips, it's going to be great. And I'm thinking, well, is it still going to be great if I don't have any hair? I mean, I haven't spent any money on haircuts in over a decade. Should I go? So I think this goes to my daughter. I think she's going to get a haircut at Great Clips. But, you know, the whole time it's just, not for me, not for me. When you open up God's word, you say, yes, this is for me. This is good. This fits. This helps me. This meets me where I'm at. This is going to make a difference. This is reliable. And so you get these fresh applications that come out of the Word that they're reading through. And you say, okay, well, what are these fresh applications? The first thing is they start to weep because sometimes when you get into God's Word and you realize how holy He truly is, that's when you realize how far we've wandered. And they started to weep over their wandering and their rebellion. But no, don't stay in that. There's grace, there's forgiveness. Nehemiah and Ezra are staying. No, don't stay in guilt and shame. God doesn't want you there. God is picking you up. He's restoring you. Grace, receive it. Receive His grace. So that was the first application. The second application was this feast. It was a Feast of the Tabernacles. In Numbers 23, Leviticus 23, there's three appointed feasts. And you see it in Leviticus, Numbers. The three feasts are Pentecost, Passover, and this Feast of Tabernacles, or booths. It came at the completion of the harvest, and it was a feast. I mean, I don't know what your backyard barbecues look like, but I mean, just picture they had steaks on the grill, maybe Outback steaks. The In-N-Out Burger catered to this. In the Hebrew, you see In-N-Out Burger brought. I miss In-N-Out Burger. We used to live in California. Our kids, one of them just wrote an email to In-N-Out Burger saying, could you come up to Seattle? If you don't like meat, they had Boca Burgers there. I mean, this was a feast. It was a camp out. It was a celebration. And it also had some real tie-in and significance to how God freed the people from slavery in Egypt. And this feast tied into, they would make huts out of branches. And they were remembering as they went through the wilderness how God guided them. He provided for them. Has God ever guided you through the wilderness? Has He ever provided for you in the wilderness? And so they set this up as God appointed it so they would remember the goodness of the Lord in some of the most difficult times in their life, and they would also remember just how far God has brought them, just how far God has brought you. You ever just sit back and say, wait a second, I remember when I didn't know the Lord. I remember when I hated God or didn't believe in God. I remember when His love broke through. You know, I remember the times He's answered prayers. I remember how He's provided for me when I didn't have much finances. If you've got a house, if you've got a car, you got clothes, He's brought friends, He's brought encouragement, and you think back just how far your character, maybe your spouse will tell you, your character, just how far you've come with God's help. They're going to celebrate that and celebrate the Lord. And as they do that, they're going to remember the people that don't have anything, and they're going to take some over there too. Fresh applications. God's Word is clear. They hear it. They live it. They follow through. My prayer as we gather here on the weekends is that God's Word, whoever's teaching, whatever age group, it would always be clear. We would hear it. And then each person decides, you know, well, what does it look like to live in it as you abide and respond? But God's going to lead you in that. And I just encourage you to say yes to fresh applications from His Word. And in verse 13 is the last thing we read. On the second day of the month, the heads of all the families, along with the priests and the Levites, they gathered around Ezra the scribe to give attention to the words of the law. They found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded through Moses, that the Israelites were to live in booths during the feast of the seventh month. And, catch this, they should proclaim this word and spread it throughout their towns. And so, go out. And they're spreading God's word. Here's the experience God wants us to have. It's when you are communicating your faith. Communicating your faith. Daily grace is our vision here, but daily grace is, yes, it's so you enjoy Jesus daily and glorify Him and His grace every day, but it's not just for you. It's that you also share His grace with other people. So as you think about, you know, how do you apply this and how do you communicate your faith, one of the pieces that you see in this passage and also in our lives and throughout the Bible, it's invitations. Invitations are so biblical. And, you know, at church here, you can invite. I was at a store not that long ago, and I saw a shirt. It was on sale. It was like 50% off. I was like, I can get this for $13. So I went over to buy it, and as I was buying it, we started a conversation, and the guy who was selling it there to me started talking about spiritual things and just had this incredible conversation. And then I thought, well, I've got to invite you, because I asked him, you know, where is he at with church these days? And he said, well, he grew up in church, and it was good, but he's just hasn't been in so long. So I just pulled out that little card. I like to carry them with me, just invites to Grace. And I said, here, I said, Sunday mornings. And he said, see, I can't do Sundays. It's like, wow, perfect timing. We just launched Saturday night. And I pulled out the card, and it was one of those old cards that only said Sunday. So I was like, you got a pen? And I write in Saturday nights, 5:00. Maybe it looked a little corny, you know, but I'm like, take my word. It's not on the card, but it's kicking up. It's going. And this conversation, and as you just have them, sometimes they just flow naturally. Sometimes you ask a question. You're just talking about your faith. But I would have paid $13 just to have the conversation. I got a shirt thrown in free, too. But as you invite, you see, and it could be Sidewalk Prophets coming up. It could be Easter coming up. There's so many opportunities to just invite someone and let them decide if they want to come, or offer them a ride. But it's so simple to invite, because this is how it works. God is the source of all joy. He wants us to taste and see that He is good. But then it's not just that we taste and see, but He wants His joy for all people. So, you know, the true biblical celebration is, yes, have the feast, have the food, have the fun, and do all that. But also, go take some to those who don't have it. Go take some to those who don't have food, who aren't making it as well. And also, go invite all into a relationship with God. Go invite and spread His love and joy to all. And especially, some are going to feel like they're not good enough or outside or not invited. Go invite them. And so God's joy spreads as you taste it and you invite other people. And so that's what we see throughout scriptures. God just wants more people to have His joy, true joy, and in spreading that. So here's the take home for today. It's actually take homes. We got plural. A couple things to think about before we head home. Number one, God directs you towards a project, a role, or a job, which is actually a gateway for His deeper purposes. That first role is a gateway so often for His deeper purposes. Nehemiah chapter 8, to be honest, as you go through this book, seems a little out of place. I mean, this whole book is about a community rolling up their sleeves, rebuilding physically the city. And then you get to chapter 8, and it's like, what's this doing here? This is a revival that breaks out. This is people's souls coming alive, and does it fit? And then it clicks, and you go, wait a second, this was God's plan. People enter in, they say, I can rebuild part of this gate right here. This door's broken, I can fix this. And they start doing that together, and it grows, and they're starting to experience God through their work, and it builds, and then they become ready for what God wants to do in their hearts. Gateway. There's negative gateways. Alcohol is said as a gateway to so many other drugs. People who start drinking, then from the drinking, they go on and they start experimenting with so many different drugs. So gateway can be negative, but God wants to redeem that concept and redeem the experience of a gateway. So how does that work? In Nehemiah, the gateway is building the gates and hearts are renewed. What does it look like in our lives? For me, soccer's been a gateway. I enjoy soccer. It's a good thing. But after I'm playing with a group of guys for a while, I start to see maybe some of them start coming to the church or come back to the Lord or get in a life group or come and know Jesus. And I realize soccer was good, but it was just kind of the gateway to some of the deeper things that God wanted to do. Some people in church will start and say, well, I just work tech behind the scenes. And, you know, over the years of doing tech, it's like they ended up coming to church all the time and hearing messages. And their faith just keeps getting stronger and stronger. And they're realizing, like, wow, it's cool. I get to serve, but my relationship with God has grown so much. Or maybe a greeter that says, you know, I was just there to greet people and welcome them, but so many conversations and friendships have grown out of that. I just realized, wow, there was something so much bigger. You can go on a mission trip to Uganda and think you're going to, you know, serve and rebuild the irrigation system, and then what God does in your own heart on that trip, and you realize that was even the deeper, greater work. Although both are good. And so what I'm saying is, say yes to that entry point, say yes to that role, and then just watch what's tied to that as you serve, and what God's plan is, and how that just gains momentum. And you'll look back and you'll say, the whole time God had this really big thing linked to this starting thing, and it's just, there it is. Harriet Tubman, I think of her example, and she was, you know, born into, I mean, as a child, was a slave, so sad, was beaten, was whipped. Her master took a heavy metal object, tried to throw it at someone else and hit her in the head as a kid and caused all kinds of pain and just suffering for her, you know, for so many years because of that. She knew she was going to escape. She knew she was going to escape. So her faith was the foundation of her life, her trust in Jesus. People would comment on that, how much she trusted God. People noticed that she consulted with God. She would talk to God. She'd spend time with him. She would listen to God. God would give her dreams and visions, sometimes warnings about what's upcoming or staying out of trouble. This is one of her prayers. She said, "Oh, dear Lord, I ain't got no friend but you. Come to my help, Lord. Come to my help." And so with God's help, and she remembered scripture, and she would sing. Others would sing with her. Her nickname was Moses, leading people out of slavery. And one of the songs she sang with the others was Moses, Go Down. And it wasn't just a song. It was only an expression of their faith, but they would change the pace of the song based on if they sensed there was some danger. The tempo of the song would change as they sang to kind of communicate with each other what's happening. So she led 13 expeditions of the Underground Railroad, and freeing people, so important, from this terrible slavery in our country. What started out as her own escape, now helping so many people to break free. And these expeditions, she had to trust. At one point, you know, there's a lot of pieces to it, but they didn't have much food. They didn't have a map. They didn't have, you know, a compass. And so as they were traveling, sometimes there was one story, Miss Parsons, who's a white woman, but God gave Harriet Tubman discernment, and she sensed that this woman was safe. So they went to her place, but then they had to go try to find another place that would be safe, and they would use the North Star. And this looked to the North Star to keep heading north, trying to make it to New York or Philadelphia. They'd follow the North Star. When the North Star wasn't visible, they just knew that moss would tend to be on the north side of the tree, and it would grow most there. So they would check that and keep heading north. And they did this just relying on the Lord and, again, moving towards freedom. By the way, she carried a gun with her because there would be animals, wild dogs that would come attack. So she carried a gun. And she also, if someone in the group wanted to, you know, veer off and say, "Oh no, I'm just going to go into the city. I'm done with this." She would pull out the gun and say, "I don't think you're going into the city," because if someone veered off, they would end up telling, and then everyone could get caught, risk everyone's life. So she had a strong side too. And she said, looking back, she was a conductor of the Underground Railroad for 8 years, and the train never ran off the track, and she never lost one passenger. By the grace of God, just a beautiful thing. And her compassion, she cared for the elderly. She cared for so many people who were sick physically. And people would remark, how is it that she never gets sick, but she's with people who are sick all the time? And it was just God's protection. She was involved in helping women to be able to vote and have that right in our nation. So important. And she really ended up leading a movement, a freedom movement that was so needed in our country. So God stirs you, and all that movement reflects God's love, his justice, his power, but God stirs you. Say yes to that first thing. You don't know what it's going to lead to, but trust the Lord. Enter in. And then drop down to verse 18. We read, day after day, kind of a new rhythm, new rhythm in our lives, day after day, daily grace, from the first day to the last, Ezra read from the book of the law of God. They celebrated the feast for 7 days, and on the eighth day, in accordance with the regulation, there was also an assembly. What I want to say here is, do not settle for noble checklists, but overlook the essential experiences. There's checklists that can even be noble, and there's essential experiences. And this community, they were religious before this revival, And, you know, in religious communities, sometimes it can be dead. It can be dead religion and checklists of, okay, we just need to check, 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 move on. And sadly, as you read the Bible, there was a legalism, religious leaders, Pharisees, Sadducees, they become checklist experts. And they could say, here's the ultimate checklist. And watch me check, 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 check. And they would say, aha, I check everything in the boxes. And they look down on everyone else because you only check part of the boxes. And so the religion became this performance thing. It was not from God. And it led to legalism. It led to pride and comparison. And it took what's supposed to be alive and all these experiences, and it made it really dead and awful and lukewarm. And that can become the norm. So breaking out of the checklist mentality, got to perform for God, for He loves me if I'm good enough, and you know, trying to make things that aren't in Scripture part of the checklist. Instead of that, there's essential experiences. Essential experiences with the Lord. So day after day, what we read here, new opportunities, alive, more of God's presence, more of His love, more of the relationship. And these experiences start to go. And then faithfulness builds momentum. So there it goes. And now it's growing and it's so healthy and it's so good what we're reading here. And I just want to think about these realms of experiences. There is the relational realm, relationship with God, and then also relationship with each other. And they're thriving in those relationships. There is an intellectual realm of experience. They are learning God's word. They're loving God with all their mind. And so that's happening. There's an emotional realm. As they're saying amen and amen, and they're weeping, they're praising the Lord, and their emotions, they're loving God with their emotions. And then volitionally, their will, that experience, they will take food to those who don't have it. They will do that. And don't settle for less. You know, you might naturally, one of those realms is stronger than another for you, but think about those realms, that shalom, wholeness, a full relationship with God that involves all of that. And so they're experiencing that. And like I say, they're coming alive. They're learning how to celebrate again. It's been a while since they really celebrated. And so do you ever kind of lose that gratitude? Lose that celebration for the Lord. I was in a grocery store shopping, and over the PA system, someone working at the grocery store said, "We have a birthday. All right, everybody, let's sing." In the grocery store. It's not what I expected. I'm just used to picking up some Cheerios and then some milk, and now all of a sudden over the intercom, so it's like, we got a birthday. I didn't even catch the name. We got a birthday. Let's everybody sing. And I'm thinking to myself, this is strange. I'm shopping somewhere else next time. And they just start singing, happy birthday. And I'm looking down aisle, you know, the aisle I'm on, aisle three, whatever it is, and everyone's singing. And everyone around, you can just hear it, is singing, happy birthday. I didn't even catch the name. Pretty soon, I'm singing happy birthday to someone I don't know. And instead of being strange, I'm thinking, this is kind of cool. This is kind of cool. We're all singing happy birthday. And you know what? They had become so accustomed to lukewarm, little bit of celebrate, golf clap for God. You know, they had been so used to that, that all of a sudden, really celebrating the Lord and His goodness, at first it's like, that's a little strange, and then they realize this is so good. And the joy grows. And in Nehemiah chapter 8, the tone, the message is the joy of the Lord. In verse 10, the joy of the Lord is your strength. It is your strength. Listen to the report in verse 17. We read, the whole company that had returned from exile, they built booths, they lived in them from the days of Joshua, long time before this, son of Nun, until that day, the Israelites had not celebrated it like this. And their joy was very great. Their joy was very great. I have this remote control to unlock my car, And for the last month, I've been playing this goofy game where sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't work. And for whatever reasons, I've just been doing that all month. And so I have to get sometimes just, you know, 2 feet from the car, trying to find, and pressing, and sometimes it works, other times it doesn't work. Sometimes I got to pull out the key and go back in old school style and just open it up. Oh, the suffering, right? But I've been through that for a month now, and finally, after a month of that, it's like, enough is enough. I'm going into the drugstore, and I'm buying a battery, and I'm popping this thing open, paying $6, and I'm putting the new battery in there, and now, when I press this, all the doors, bing, they're all open. And I'm finding that I'm even like 30 feet away, just looking that way, going, bing, and all the doors. Behind the back, going, bing, all the doors are working. $6, I waited a month for that. What was I thinking, doing halfway business for a month? Some of us have been doing halfway business, halfway praise, and it's just time, that renewal that comes. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Meoz, strength in the Hebrew, fortress. It is your fortress in your life. You can have that fortress of the joy of the Lord, or you can be grumpy. That's the other option. You can be grumpy. It's kind of like going into the ditch, just being grumpy. The fortress or the ditch? Grumpy. Repeat after me. Grumpy is a choice. Do you believe that? Grumpy is a choice. The joy of the Lord going that way. Grumpy is going that way. Which road should I go down? And it's not really close. You don't have to like study it, analyze it, watch the film again and try and decipher. Was that the joy of the Lord or was that grumpy? I can't tell. It is really, really obvious. And if you don't know if you've been grumpy, ask the three people you hang out with the most. Just say, have I been once in a while partially, semi, little bit grumpy at all? And if they love you, they'll be honest. And you say, it's time to shift for the joy of the Lord. Because they had been rebuilding a city, but God wanted to rebuild their faith. They had rebuilt a city, but God wanted to rebuild their joy. They had been rebuilding that city. God wanted to rebuild their hearts. And you can't fake the joy of the Lord. It comes from deep, and it's from deep that God meets us, and he brings his joy. Who is the source of all joy? God. Who invented joy? Who invented celebration? God. Who invented parties? God. I read it in my Bible. Every time someone turns to the Lord, comes back to the Lord, discovers the Lord, there's joy in a party in heaven with the angels. There's thousands of parties every day in heaven. Now, we have tainted experiences of parties down here that don't always show the glory of God. But God is the source of joy. And my challenge today is, when you think of God, what's your image of him? Do you see his joy? Do you see his joy over you, singing over you? Do you see his joy even in giving his life for you on the cross? Do you see his joy when you seek him, his joy for you? He's the source of joy. He's just, joy abounds. And so my prayer this week is that we'd have a Nehemiah 8 week. Renewal, joy, the joy of the Lord. The take home is, you gain strength when you learn to enjoy God. You gain strength when you learn to enjoy God. Let's pray. Father, so often we get busy and everything's about our jobs, our to-do lists, our roles. And Lord, for us just to step back today, like they did in Nehemiah chapter 8, and for you to come and just work right in our hearts and take those areas that are grumpy and we don't have gratitude, and Lord, your presence, we return to you today. Thank you that you forgive. Thank you that you're gracious. Thank you that you have experiences for us as we follow you that are so rich. And God, we pray that your joy would be our strength. And Father, if anyone here hasn't yet put their trust in you We just know that all the time, Jesus, you are inviting into a relationship with you, into daily grace. And so for the first time ever, you can put your trust in Jesus because he already loves you, already pursues you. But you say, yes, Lord, I want to follow you. And I'm not going to earn it. It's not checklist, performance. But instead, your grace, an undeserved gift. You died on the cross. You're risen. And I want to follow you. And Lord, we worship you. We give you praise together. May we take your word, receive it, live it, and pass it on to others. In your name we pray. Amen.